I met the Georgi in 1967, so it's half a century minus epsilon. And Stampakia had invited me to Pisa. In fact, I was both excited and nervous because this was the first invitation I ever received in my life and the first mathematical invitation. And when Stampakia invited me, he said he was very modest, as you know, he was really very modest. And he said, you should come to Pisa, not because of me, but to meet De Giorgi, you should meet Bombieri. And indeed, this was, Pisa was an extraordinary place in 1967, extraordinary atmosphere. It's always been, and again these days, it's a thriving place, but at that time it was very special. And I can say that it had a tremendous impact. This visit in 67 for 1 month had a tremendous impact on my career. And I really consider myself a product, at least partially a product of the Italian school, of this great Italian school of mathematics. At that time, I also met many people who were young, who were students, postdocs, and since then they remained friends. One person who could not come today, but I talked to him, is Ambrosetti, and I see many faces here in the audience. Marino was there. Ugo da Vega was a student. Then Giusti Spagnolo, you were there, right, in 67? Or did you come? You were there. Yeah, many other who today they are the old generation, but I can tell you, in 67, we were all young, so. I must confess that throughout my life, I always had a pinch in the heart when I entered De Giorgi's office, always, throughout his life. And the room was dark. Very often there was shade, and when some lamp was on, but it was dark. And entering the Scuola Normale was like entering a temple. And then in this temple, you had the Holy of Holies. This was the De Giorgi's office, and it was dark. And De Giorgi would make me comfortable. And especially in periods when I was working on subjects which were close to his interest, he was, for example, when I was working on the Ginzburg-Landau problem with a small parameter epsilon, this was close to his interest, the work they had done on Allen-Kahn equation, so it was very close to his interest. And then he was full of reactions, full of questions, comments, making conjectures. Louis mentioned yesterday that they did not talk mathematics, but I think my conjecture is that once the subject was very close to his interest and he was full, De Giorgi was full of life. And one of the things that I like very much about De Giorgi is that he was always surrounded by young people, always. There was a group of 5, sometimes 10 young people around him, and he was talking, mentioning to one of the students, am I right to say this, and so forth. So this was a wonderful experience. And then after this discussion in his office, we would walk in the street. And walking in the street in Pisa with De Giorgi was also a special experience. I remember one image which remained with me. There was an old man in the street on a bicycle coming in the opposite direction. This is a very simple man dressed with very simple clothes and obviously a worker. And when he passed, the Giorgi, removed his hat, and he said, "Buongiorno, professore." And this, for me, was a scene coming straight from a movie, maybe a De Sica movie, or really. And then we went to eat, and then the conversation changed. Louis mentioned his interest in human rights, and in fact, he would always ask me questions about a French organization led by Henri Carton and Laurent Schwartz called the Comité des Mathématiciens, which was fighting for human rights. So he was asking what are the latest news, and then he would pull out of his pocket a large bill and say, "Please, give it to Laurent Schwartz for the Comité des Mathématiciens." Very generous. And sometimes we would discuss also the Bible. He had interest, as you know, he had great interest in the book of Proverbs, and he asked me about the Jewish interpretation. In fact, maybe some of you know that I have a book called Jewish Mathematician, Mathematicien Juif. And it turns out that De Giorgi was partially responsible for this book. Originally, the editor of this series called Scientists and Believers, and the various sciences, various beliefs, several religions, and the head of this series had asked De Giorgi, "Would you be willing to do a book with me in the form of an interview about your beliefs and the interaction with science?" And De Giorgi said, "Well, I could do it, but it would be more special if this is a Jewish mathematician. Why don't you go and ask Brezis?" And first I was a bit uncomfortable doing such a book, but then when I heard that the Giorgi was behind this, and then I accepted, and unfortunately he died a little before the book was finished and published. I have many beautiful memories of the Giorgi's visit to Paris. I don't know if they can show. Yeah, here is a picture. Maybe, can you please enlarge the picture? Yes. So this is a photograph from November 1983, when De Giorgi received a honorary degree at Paris 6. This is in the Sorbonne. So this is the ceremony. You can see De Giorgi is sitting here. And then he gives a speech at the ceremony, and you can see some people in the audience. There was also a very nice ceremony when he was received a foreign member of the, I'm sure you recognize many faces here, his Italian friends of De Giorgi made a big delegation to come to Paris for this event. And there were happy moments also when De Giorgi was received a foreign member of the French Academy. And I have painful memories when I visited De Giorgi in the hospital. He was treated, he came to Paris to be treated for cancer. There is a famous hospital in Paris for cancer. And I visited him several times there, and it was more difficult. I could speak for an hour about De Giorgi, but I'll stop here. And first of all, I would like to thank the organizer for inviting me, especially Luigi Ambrosio. First, I'm delighted to pay tribute to the memory of De Giorgi, but also because my lecture today is closely connected to two topics that where De Giorgi was so influential. One of them is a theory of BV functions, and the other is the concept of gamma limit that De Giorgi introduced and which plays a central role in my lecture. So in some sense, Pisa is the ideal place to give this lecture, and I hope some of you come with comments or maybe solutions, feedback solutions to my open problems. This is a subject which I have had on my mind for maybe more than almost 15 years. And I apologize, maybe you heard me talk about previous versions of these lectures, but I please ask you to forget everything you heard in the past, because there were some mistakes, so don't be too serious. Don't quote me about something that I said 5 years ago. There might have been some, not serious mistakes, but I forgot some assumptions and so forth. I hope now I hope everything now is correct. Can we pass to my, can we pass to my lecture? Yeah. So here is the plan of my lecture. First of all, I will give you some background to explain where we are heading, why we reach this, this kind of problem. And also, I'll show you a very simple computation. They're very, very simple that you can use as an exercise for students, and which was at the heart of my talk. Then I will discuss pointwise convergence. Pointwise convergence turns out to be very erratic and misleading. It's not the right, clearly not the right concept. And it's De Giorgi with his gamma convergence concept which saves the situation. And then at the end, I will explain where these problems occur in image processing. Okay, so let me explain. The beginning of the story is really from a paper that we wrote with Bourguin and Mironescu in 2001. And I can state the result, very easy to understand. Omega throughout the lecture will be a bounded domain in Rn. If you like, you can also take all of Rn, but I prefer to stick with a bounded domain, smooth bounded domain. And I take a family of mollifiers, of radial mollifiers, rho epsilon. In fact, the name mollifier is a little bit misleading because those rho epsilon, they need not be smooth as usual. You just assume that they are L1 log functions. So they are radial, they depend only on variable r going from 0 to infinity. They are non-negative, and the integral is 1. Normalize it to be 1, and I assume that rho epsilon tends to a Dirac mass, means that if you integrate from 0 to a, where a is any positive number, then you already get convergence to 1 as epsilon goes to 0. And here is the main object. The main object is a non-local functional. The double integral u of x minus u of y, absolute value, divided by x minus y, times rho epsilon of x minus y. And I can state immediately our main result. So main result is due to Bourguin, Mironescu, and myself, 2001, and a refinement by Juan Davila, who made our result more complete. So the first statement is that you start with, I define it for every function u in L1 or every measurable function. So this integral possibly could be infinite. And the first assertion is that the function u, which a priori is in L1, belongs to BV if and only if that quantity, J epsilon, remains bounded along a sequence epsilon n going to zero if this lim inf is finite. And in that case, we can add, moreover, that J epsilon converges to a constant times the total variation, the integral of gradient U, which is well defined if U is in BV, and if U is not in BV, this limit is plus infinity. This is not a very difficult result, and as you can see, because rho epsilon is a mollifier tending to a Dirac mass, X will be very close to Y in some sense, and then U of X will be close to U of Y. You can do some formal asymptotics, use a Taylor expansion. This will be like a derivative, and then this, in as epsilon goes to zero, this tends, at least formally, you believe that this tends to the total variation, and you can compute the constant Kn. Is an explicit constant. It's the measure of the ball in twice the measure of the ball in Rn minus 1. And concretely, the way it appears is that it's an integral on the sphere of dimension n minus 1 of sigma dot e. E is any unit vector. So
the mean is the total variation.
I'm sorry?
U is in BV,
and this is
the
integral is the total variation. Yeah, the integral of absolute gradient of U is a measure, and this is the total mass, the mass of the measure. Okay, clear? Okay, now, as I said, this is not difficult, but strangely enough, it has never appeared in the literature, never occurred to anyone. It should have been discovered long ago. And here, the mode of convergence is very robust. Any kind of convergence that you can think of will be okay. For example, it's also true that J epsilon converges to the total variation in the sense of gamma convergence. This was proved by Augusto Ponce, and nothing very difficult here. And I just wrote down two typical examples of rho epsilon. One of them is I take for rho epsilon the characteristic function of the interval 0 epsilon. And of course, I have to divide it by epsilon to the n so that the normalization is normalized, the integral is 1. And so if you plug this into into the definition, then you get the integral, the double integral, over the set where x minus y is less than epsilon, and you divide by epsilon to the n, and you get the convergence of that expression to a constant times the total variation. Another example, which is also of interest, is you take this singular function on the interval 0, 1, 1 over r to the n minus epsilon, and you can see because of this factor epsilon that you, if you integrate this r n minus 1 dr, then the integral is 1, so this is typically a sequence of mollifiers. It's a strange sequence of mollifiers, but they are mollifiers in our sense. And if you plug this into the integral, you get that expression, and you get the convergence of this integral, where in the denominator you have n plus 1 minus epsilon, and you have a factor epsilon in front, and all this converges to the total variation with the cons of u times the constant Kn. And if you take in particular U to be the characteristic function of a set, you get that it converges to the perimeter times some constant. And this is the kind of result which has been of interest to a number of people, sometimes rediscovering without knowing our result. I should mention in particular the work of Ambrosio De Filippis and Martinazzi. Very often they go under the name non-local perimeter, non-local minimal surfaces, etc. And you have also work of Caffarelli and Valdinocchi, work of Fusco, etc. It's been quite popular in recent years. Now, when we did this work with Bourguin and Mironescu, I played with related non-local integrals. At least they seem to be related. I had no motivation in mind, just for fun. And I discovered that other functionals, which were a bit reminiscent of what we had with Bourguin and Mironescu, had the same property, that they converged to the total variation. So here is a typical one that I found in 2002. I call it L delta. So this is a double integral, also non-local functional, 1 over x minus 1 to the n plus 1. And I integrate over the set where u of x minus u of y is bigger than delta. And I put a factor delta in front. And the main result, I'll state it in a second, playing at least formally, I discovered that this converges, an integral like this converges also, at least formally, when u is smooth, to the constant times the total variation. Now, it turns out that the two functionals both converge to the total variation, but they have a very different character. For example, the first functional that I call J epsilon is convex. And this place simplifies, is a very, very helpful fact. This functional L delta is not a convex function of U. Also, if you look at the special case that I gave you, which was x minus y less than epsilon, here you see it's a completely different set. I integrate on the set where u of x minus u of y is less than delta. And that's a difference here is a comment that I heard from Jean-Michel Morel. He said this difference because it connects with things that he has been doing in image processing. He said, you know, the difference is a little bit, the first integral reminds me of a Riemann integral, the definition of the Riemann integral, where you slice in x minus y is less than epsilon. And here it's a bit like the Lebesgue integral, when you slice in the horizontal lines. Okay, so here is a fact that I proved that not very difficult. In fact, I will show you, I'll sketch the proof in a few minutes for you of this fact that if u is smooth, then L delta u tends to the total variation times the same constant Kn, exactly the same constant. And I'll call this later a suggestive computation. And when I discovered that, I said, well, it would be nice if we had the same property as for the other functional. So I raised the question, is it true that u belongs to BV if and only if this quantity L delta remains bounded along a subsequence, as we had before for the other functionals? And if so, is it true that the limit, the full limit of L delta as delta goes to zero is precisely the total variation? Now, it turns out that this question was much, much harder, no comparison with the result that I presented before, and it really generated this question generated lots of results, both on the positive side and on the negative side. And the first result on the negative side, which came to me as a surprise, because I was sure that because the limit is the total variation, I was sure that if I have, for example, a function in W11, that the limit of L delta of U is the integral of gradient U. I was sure of that. And Augusto Ponce, to my big surprise and disappointment, produced a counterexample. He constructed a function in W11 where this limit is infinite. Very strange, because if U is C1, you have the limit is the W11 norm, and if U is just W11, the limit could be plus infinity. I ask, well, okay, in that direction, the answer is negative. How about the other direction? That is, if you know that this limit is finite or along a subsequence, could it be true that the function is BV? Okay, the converse, I said, might be true. I ask the students that I had around, Augusto Ponce, no result, Jean Schaffinger, very talented young people. And it turned out that I asked also in Guyenne at that time, no way to crack this this question. Even in 1D, I forgot to mention that many of the results are already non-trivial in 1D, which is usually 1D, you think you know everything, and here there are still open problems even in 1D. Okay, and I was a little bit desperate, and I was meeting Bourguin, and I said, you know, we don't have the answer. It looks like a very simple question. And Bourguin, after a few weeks, took him a few weeks, so it's not completely trivial, said, I have an idea. I think the answer is positive. And indeed, then combining with ideas and Guyenne had, the two of them proved the result that if the lim inf is finite, then the function is in BV, and it comes with a control of the BV norm is controlled by a constant times this lim int, which is finite. And then I said, how about the second part of my question? If this lim int is finite, is it true that the full limit is exists, and it is the total variation with the same constant, and this turns out the answer is negative, but this took a long time, and only recently that we found an example where this lim inf is finite and the limit L delta does not have a limit, as delta can goes to zero, it can have oscillations and so forth. So lots of pathologies, and then because of I became nervous about this function L delta, and I said pointwise convergence is not the right setting. And by pointwise convergence, I hope you understand what I mean. I fixed the function U, fixed, and I want to know what happens to L delta, to this non-local functional of U. And so I noticed this pointwise convergence was very misleading and erratic. And I said, I told Guyenne, how about proving convergence in the sense of gamma limit? So that was my question. And Guyenne took him several years. You see, I raised that question in 2006. Guyenne published a beautiful paper in 2011, where he indeed proved the gamma convergence, that this non-local functional converges to L0, which is a multiple of the total variation. And to my big surprise, this multiple here, and we'll come back to that, was not the constant Kn that I had expected. It was a smaller constant than the one that I was expecting, and could be strictly smaller. So this, of course, from this result, this gamma convergence, is much stronger than the result of Bourguin and Guyenne, which deals with pointwise convergence. So this is a big improvement over the results of Bourgagne. That's a beautiful, beautiful result, complicated result. And by some very lucky coincidence, it happened that after Nguyen finished his paper, I was talking to people in Israel at the Technion, people from computer science, which were involved in image processing. And they mentioned to me that non-local functionals of this form, a function of u of x minus u of y divided by delta times a weight functions, were very commonly used in image processing. And I said, it was a funny discussion because I said, please, can you give me some references about those works? And they said, you know who is the leading expert? This is your student, Jean-Michel Morel. And I had no more connection. He had been my student long ago in Paris, but we didn't keep in touch because he was moving into image processing, where he became one of the leaders. And so I reconnected with Jean-Michel Morel, and he explained to me that indeed this kind of functionals occurred in image processing, played an important role. And if you see that if you take this Heaviside function, if phi is a Heaviside function, 0 if t is less than 1, and 1 if t is bigger than 1, and as a weight function, the 1 over x minus y to the n plus 1, we get exactly the functional that I had written down just for fun. And so I proposed in 2011 to Nguyen that we should study together this kind of non-local functionals, and especially what happens as delta goes to 0. So the result is, the outcome is a very long paper that we just finished a few weeks ago. You can find it on archive, it's on the internet. And a part of it concerns the pointwise convergence, where basically we show that lots of things can go wrong. There are many pathologies that can happen, and then about half of the paper, of this long paper, is devoted to the proof of gamma convergence. Okay, so here's the beginning of my talk. And so if you want to wake up, it's the right time to, if you have been sleeping until now, it's the right time to wake up, and you can start just start from here. So omega is in Rn, and as I said, n possibly equal to 1, which is amazing. Dimension 1 has plenty of open problems. And the case of interest for image processing is, of course, n equals 2. And we take a fixed function phi. I'm going to show you what kind of functions we have in mind in a minute. You fix a function phi from the positive to the positive. So phi here is a fixed given function to start with, and u is a variable function, an L1 or measurable function. And you consider this non-local functional phi of ux, absolute value of ux minus uy, divided by x minus y to the n plus 1 dx with dy, so it could be infinite. And what is of interest to us, and especially because there is a small constant delta which appears in problems of image processing, you rescale it. So you take instead phi of ux minus uy divided by delta, keep this weight, and you put a delta in front. Delta in front, as delta goes to 0, you see this factor goes to 0. And if you remember the example that I gave you at the beginning, where this was the integral, the double integral on the set where u of x minus u of y is bigger than delta, when you let delta go to 0, then u of x minus u of y positive, this is basically everything, and then the integral that you have is 1 over x minus y to the n plus 1. This is a divergent integral. So usually this term would tend to 0, I'm sorry, would tend to infinity, this double integral tends to infinity, and the factor there in front goes to 0. So you see 0 should balance infinity, and the remarkable fact is that this product, 0 times infinity, will converge to the total variation. The function phi that we have in mind are a quite general class. Here are the basic assumptions that we'll always assume. Phi is a non-decreasing function on 0 infinity. It's continuous with possible finite number of discontinuities, like the Heaviside function. Near the origin, it's bounded by a constant times t squared. So near the origin, it will be like t squared. And when you go near infinity, it will be bounded. And I make this assumption. You see, the integral from 0 to infinity is finite, because near the origin, I know that phi of t divided by t squared is bounded. So this remains bounded. And near infinity, phi is bounded. So this is like 1 over t squared. So this integral, because of our assumption, this integral is finite. And I want to renormalize it with the constant k sub n. This is just a convenience, and then we don't see any more the constant k sub n in there. Okay, so I will show you where it enters this normalization condition. The type of function that I want you to keep in mind are this Heaviside function, phi, and then you multiply it, if needed, those functions, you multiply them by a constant in order to satisfy the normalization condition. So here is this is an interesting function, phi. In fact, this was the function that Nguyen worked with throughout his big paper. And then two other functions which play a role, which come from image processing, is this function which is exactly equal to t squared near the origin and identically equal to 1 when t is bigger than 1. And another example which is really quite present in image processing is this type of function, 1 minus e to the minus t squared. You see, as t goes to 0, this goes to 0 like t squared, and as t goes to infinity, this goes to 1 very quickly. So keep in mind those functions phi. Okay, so first of all, some results about pointwise convergence. If you fix the function u and as a smooth function, C1 function, then lambda delta of u, this non-local functional, converges to the total variation with the constant 1 in front instead of the constant kn. That's now because I've introduced the constant kn as a normalization factor, and so this is 1 here because of the normalization condition. This is a fairly easy result, and I will show you can give it as an exercise to students. It's an amusing exercise when you have UC1, so all they need to know is a C1 function, and I'll show you the computation. It's really an easy computation. And then you ask the question, well, suppose U is not C1, what can you do? And for example, natural question is u is in W1p. Still true, that you have convergence with the constant 1 when p is strictly 1 between 1 and infinity. But then this is not quite, at least the proof we have is not an exercise for first year or second year students, because the proof already at this stage involves the use of maximal functions. That's why p must be strictly bigger than 1. And if u is in w11, then all we can say is that this lim inf is of lambda delta of u is greater than or equal than the total variation. So as I said, the proof of Semon is a bit complicated, not complicated, but uses some machinery like maximal functions. This is not too bad. It just relies on FATU. So if you have taught FATU to your students, you can give this as an exercise. So here is a very simple computation that I want to share with you, because it's so simple and it gives an idea why you have convergence to the total variation. What you do is you take lambda delta and you split it into two parts. In the region where x minus y is less than delta to the alpha, you fix a number alpha strictly less than this. You'll see immediately why. So you split the integral into two pieces. The second part is harmless. It goes to zero, because you remember we had the phi and we had 1 minus 1 over x minus y. But because we're in this region, 1 over x minus y to the n plus 1, sorry, is smaller than 1 over delta to the alpha times n plus 1, which is strictly less than 1. And so the delta that you have in front kills everything, and you are left just with this region. Okay. Now, in this region, you change variables. You call this x plus h instead of y. And h will be, sorry, I'm losing my voice. And h is the h is less than delta to the alpha. And now, because h is small, less than delta, and let delta goes to zero, you can do a Taylor's expansion that you plug in here. And the first term in the expansion will give you h dot the gradient of u at x divided by delta. And I forget about the rest in the expansion, which is cheating a little bit, because that's inside the function phi. Phi is not Lipschitz, not even continuous, but this can be fixed. Okay, and then you use polar coordinates. You do this change of variable, you write this integral in polar coordinates, then you make a change of variable, and then you let delta go to infinity. And here you have pops out the value of the integral of 0 to infinity of phi of s divided by s squared. So this, remember, the normalization condition is that this is 1 over k to the n. And this integral that you have here, if you put a general vector and you look at this integral on the sphere, sigma dot v, any vector, this will be just the length of the vector times this normalization constant, kn, and so you get immediately that a delta goes to 1. So this is formal computations, and I must say at the beginning when I saw this, I was very happy. I was hoping that everything would go smoothly, and pathologies started to pop out from all directions. So here are some pathologies about pointwise convergence. So this was typically the kind of pathology that Augusto Ponce discovered. Now we have other functions which are simpler than the one that Augusto Ponce considered, where the limit, so there is a function u in W11, where the limit is not the total variation, but it is plus infinity. And you have also, this took some time to construct, you can construct functions in W11, where lambda delta fails to converge. For example, it might be that the limit sup is plus infinity and the lim inf is the total variation. Okay, so in some sense, this is a maximal gap that you could have, because we know by essentially FATU that the lim inf should be greater than or equal. Here you can construct a case where it's exactly equal, but the lim sup is plus infinity. And things get even much worse when you go to BV. You can construct a BV function. It's non-trivial, even say in dimension one. You can construct a function in BV where this lim inf is not greater than or equal. I said this is true for W11, but you can find if function is in BV, this lim inf could be even strictly less than the total variation. So really completely erratic. I don't know what kind of good results I would prove for pointwise convergence. And very fortunately, this concept that De Giorgi introduced, the gamma convergence, turns out to be the right tool and saves the situation. So here is basically in my lecture, there are essentially two results, fairly simple to state. This is one about the gamma convergence, saying that for any function phi, take your favorite function phi, in this class, you can have a constant k. There is a constant k depending on phi, but independent of the domain omega. And this constant k is between 0 and 1. K is strictly positive. This is a very important fact about the constant k. It's less than or equal than 1, such that lambda delta converges to lambda 0, where lambda 0 is this multiple of the total variation, multiple with this constant k. So that's it, gamma convergence to this functional in the L1 sense, gamma convergence in L1 to this functional, which is a multiple of the. So you see, there's a very surprising fact that pointwise, if you take u to be smooth, you have convergence to the total variation with constant 1. But when you take in the sense of gamma converge, gamma limit, you have to put this constant k in front. And in fact, one of the major open problems, and surprisingly, very surprising open problem, is that how can you decide whether this constant k, can you decide whether this constant k equals 1? Perhaps we don't have a single example. We don't know what happens in some special cases. Possibly, perhaps a constant is equal to 1. I doubt. My conjecture is always this constant is always strictly less than 1, but we are unable to prove it. We just know it in some special case. I'll mention this in a second. And so I believe that in Pisa, everyone knows what is gamma convergence, but anyway, you have it here. Two properties that G1 for any sequence, U delta converging to U, any U in L1, the lim inf should be greater than or equal. And G2 is that for any U, you can construct, and usually by brute force, a sequence U delta tilde such that the lim sup is in the reverse direction. Okay, I'll make some quick comments. It would be totally impossible to say anything about the proof. In our new paper, you have about 30 pages, but Some of the results that we quote, they come from the paper of Nguyen, and so I would say maybe you add another 20 pages. So altogether, the proof of this simple-looking theorem takes about 50 pages, and it would be nice if someone here in the audience has idea about how to simplify, maybe simplify some parts of the proof. The fact that the constant k, second comment, is the fact this constant k is strictly positive is non-trivial, is already non-trivial. And a special case of that is the thing that started the whole business where Bourguin was involved, and it implies in particular, you see, it implies in particular that under the assumption that of the question that I mentioned earlier where Bourguin was involved, it implies that the function u is in BV. Because you see here, if you have a sequence u delta n converging to u in L1, and if this lim inf is finite, then because of the gamma convergence to lambda naught with this positive constant, you can conclude that the function u is in BV, and it comes with an estimate. So already this fact that k is strictly positive is a non-trivial fact. As I said here, this constant k is very mysterious. It depends on the function phi, and it's not clear. My conjecture is that it's always strictly less than one. I don't know. Possibly, maybe we don't even know how to prove this. We have no idea what is k. K is perhaps equal to one, even in this important case from image processing. Anyway, this is a question for the mathematician. As you are going to see in a minute, people in image processing, they don't care what is k. The important fact, whether k is one or not, and that's irrelevant for the application image processing. The important fact there is that the constant k is strictly positive. But as a mathematician, it's very puzzling, and I would love to understand what the fact that we have very little information about this constant k is that I will give you sketch the proof. It's the constant k appears in a quite, I would say, semi-explicit. It's not in a semi-explicit form, and which gives very little information about this constant k. In fact, we don't know what is the exact value of k, even in dimension one. Even for this very simple Heaviside function, we have no idea what is this constant k. In fact, this was already in the paper of Nguyen that for the Heaviside function that he handled, the constant k is strictly less than one. And the proof is very weird. I want to tell you what is the idea of the proof, not the full proof, but I find it quite bizarre. So here is the idea of the proof that in this case it's strictly less than one. What you do, let me sketch it in dimension one. You take the interval 0, 1, and phi is phi 1, this Heaviside function. And you fix this function, capital U, which is just the identity. Capital U is a smooth function, just the identity, x, on the interval 0, 1. And we know, because for C1 functions we know everything, we know that this limit is the total variation with the constant 1. And so it's the integral of U prime. In this case, U prime is 1, so this is 1. So we know that if you just look at pointwise convergence, you get the limit 1. Okay, now here's a brute force construction. One can construct, and here you have the picture, a family u delta of functions which are converging to u, even uniformly, as delta goes to 0, such that the lim inf is strictly less than 1. And once you have that, you enter this in the definition of gamma convergence, and this will tell you that the constant k must be strictly less than 1. It suffices to construct one such example. And the construction is here. You construct a function which lots of jumps and oscillation. Well, jumps are not very important, but the fact that it oscillates a lot, Surprisingly, you would expect, because this is some kind of energy, it's the total variation, it's a kind of energy. You would expect that because you do all those oscillations, it's going to increase the energy. Surprisingly, and I didn't believe it at the beginning, it was Nguyen who discovered this phenomenon. I thought this is impossible, that with this choice of U delta, it's going to increase, it's going to be bigger than one. It turns out you can do, I did the computation 5 times, and indeed, it's very surprising. And it works because the function phi is so special. This function phi is a Heaviside function. You can do lots of explicit computation. Very bizarre fact, and we cannot reproduce this kind of argument for the other functions phi, which we have in mind. So here is just, in a few lines, the structure of the proof of the theorem 1. We take Q, as I told you, this constant K. The theorem gives a constant K, which is independent of the domain. So you fix omega, at least to start with, you fix omega to be the unit cube in Rn. And you'd fix this function U, fix, probably this function is not terribly important, but it's a simple function, this function x1 plus x2 plus xn. So in 1D, this would be just like the function x that we took before. So it's normalized with total variation is 1. And here is a definition of the constant k. Take this, the infimum. That's really very much in the spirit of what the way De Giorgi was expressing gamma convergence. You take the lim inf over all possible sequences, U delta, which converge to this special function capital U. You take the lim inf as delta goes to 0, and then you take the infimum over all possible limits. So it's not explicit. It's kind of, I call it semi-explicit. And the core of the proof, there's a very long proof, prove that indeed with this constant k, the theorem holds with this particular value of the function of the constant k. Okay. Now, maybe a few minutes just to give you an idea about things in image processing, the way things are entering. So it's a very big field, image processing, denoising, improving the quality of the images.
What happens, the strategy is that here is expressed in terms of a variational formulation. Sometimes instead of the variational formulation, you just look at the corresponding Euler equation. You have an image F is a given. That's a bad image. It has been transmitted to you. It's been damaged in the transmission. This is F. And then you minimize lambda times the integral of f minus u plus some functional capital F. Capital F is called the filter, and it's a functional, and there are many filters which are used in practice. It's very empirical, still is very empirical science, but very useful. I'm sure all of you don't know it, but you have in your pocket, in your cell phone, you have a filter. And let me mention two of the popular filters. One is due to Rudin, Osher, and Fatemi in 1992. And this is just the total variation, okay? So here is the corresponding minimization problem. Minimize lambda times the integral of f minus u squared plus this capital F of u. Lambda is so-called fidelity parameter. It's fixed by the experts. They just know, they have a feeling about how to choose lambda. If you choose lambda too big, it's like if you divide by lambda is very big, then in some sense this has no effect, the filter has no effect. So you don't want lambda to be too big, otherwise it's very, fidelity is perfect because the minimizer is f equals u, but you have not improved the quality of the image. On the other hand, if you fix lambda equals 0, you just minimize this, which has no information about this bad image. So you fix it somewhere the experts know where, how you choose lambda. Okay, so this is one type of filter, the Roth filter. It's here, and mathematically, this is not terribly interesting because from the point of view, existence, uniqueness, this is a convex functional, and you have a unique minimizer in BV, etc. Okay, a second type of filter is exactly this type of filter, which is now reminiscent of what we did, and it goes, it was introduced in the mid-80s, and then many, many people used variants of it, of this form. They have this form for a specific weight function. Okay, the W of x minus y is a function that experts use, and again, phi is at their disposal. One of the favorite functions, phi, is the function phi 3, which I mentioned at the beginning. If you are interested, a good reference for this kind of so-called neighborhood filters is this paper of, there is a paper, a review paper of Boades, Cole, and Morel, in the SIAM review of 2010, and they talk there about this neighborhood filter. And if you see, this is exactly the kind of thing that Morel was mentioning to me about neighborhood. Neighborhood means that, in his sense here, in the sense that people use it, is not that x minus y is less than epsilon, like we had before. What it is, if you read what they have written there, the neighborhood filters take into account the grayscale values to define neighboring pixels. So you average among areas where u of x is close to u of y. And so what mathematically we suggest is you take the function phi, is one of your favorite functions in this class. The fidelity parameter we want to choose, it's important for us, of the form 1 over delta, and the weight function is this. I've been discussing this with people in image processing, the weight function, because anyway they do numerical analysis, and x minus y, this is not really absolutely sacred, you can change this. And so because of this fidelity parameter, which is 1 over delta, so the delta comes in front of the functional, and now we have exactly what I call the functional lambda delta, and here is our second main result. If you assume that the function phi is in A, and in addition phi is strictly positive, that's an additional assumption, but it's satisfied. For example, in those two examples of image processing, it would not be satisfied for the Heaviside function, but for image processing example. Then, for every delta, you have a U delta, which is a minimizer, not unique, because this functional is definitely not convex, but you have the existence of a minimizer, U delta, and as delta goes to 0, U delta goes to U0, which is the solution of the Roth problem, and the constant K is the constant which comes in my previous theorem about gamma convergence. I must say that we are quite proud of this part 2, the convergence of this neighborhood filter delta to the Roth filter. And I'm a bit proud of this because, those of you who have experience talking to applied mathematicians, when you tell them a result, they know it already. Here, we told them, the neighborhood filters converges as delta goes to 0 to the raw filter. They said, really? Really? They were very surprised. It is not concretely, does not, so it's not every day that you can teach something something new to applied people. And it's not that now they are going to work with the ROF. In fact, they don't quite like the ROF. So they will still stick with the delta problem. But you know, it's good. The research, it was such an empirical science that it's good to put some order. It's a little bit like in fluid mechanics. You have the Boltzmann equation, you have the Euler equation, the Navier-Stokes equation, and you don't know quite which one to use, but it depends on the regime. Of course, there are some regimes where it's preferred to work with Boltzmann rather than Euler or Navier-Stokes, etc. But it's good to put some order, to classify them, and to say, in the limit, the Boltzmann will converge to Euler, etc., etc. So, in some sense, our theorem, that's exactly what it does here. In the part one, we are also a bit proud of part one, which meant this was the existence of a minimizer, because the functional that we have here, this functional, is definitely not convex. So all the tools that you have usually that you're using in functional analysis to prove existence of minimizers, they use convexity one way or another. If you don't have anything else, you use convexity, and the existence of a minimizer is fairly easy. Here, the existence of a minimizer is something new. I must say here, they didn't care. People in image processing, I told them, you know, this minimizer that you are looking exists. They said, who cares? For the first part, they were not interested. They say, anyway, we're not using the exact minimizer. We use almost minimizers, and etc. Okay, so final word, and then I'm going to quit, about the tools for proving existence of a minimizer. They use two new compactness lemma of two different kinds. Well, they look a bit similar, but they are somewhat different. Here, the first lemma refers to the existence of a minimizer for fixed delta, and it says that this set of points U in L1 with norm of U bounded in L1 such that lambda delta of U is bounded by C is compact in L1. This is a little bit in the limit. As delta goes to zero, this would be reminiscent of the fact that BV is contained in L1 with compact injection. But you see, here we don't pass to the limit as delta goes to zero, just the very fact that for fixed delta, and delta could be, for example, 1, that this set is compact. Okay, and a second lemma which talks about passage to the limit as delta goes to 0. If you know this bound and you have also this bound on lambda delta, then the U delta is relatively compact for the strong topology in L1. And then, of course, when you have convergence of the U delta, you may use the gamma convergence theorem 1, and this is basically the end of the proof. Now, this lemma 1 and 2, the two lemmas, they use a funny inequality, which I have written here. It's just, so here it has nothing to do with gamma convergence or function phi. It's just an inequality about functions, a new inequality about functions. And it was originally due to Guyenne, and it has roots in the paper of Bourguin and Guyenne, that if you take any function U in L1, so this is an amusing new inequality, not totally trivial, that for any function U in L1, this double integral u of x minus u of y in absolute value is controlled by 1 plus a constant, 1 plus this double integral, which pops out all the time, the integral over the set where u of x minus u of y is bigger than 1, of 1 divided by x minus y to the n plus 1, a funny new inequality. And I wonder if the proof can be simplified. It looks so simple that I hope someone can find a simple proof. It's also an open direction. It's not clear what is the role of this one. I don't like it too much. What I would prefer to have an inequality where on the left-hand side you also integrate on a set where u of x minus u of y is bigger than one. For example, I don't know if this inequality is true or not. Maybe here you have to modify, maybe you have to put here one and maybe one half. But anyway, this kind of, so I challenge and I hope, really hope to have a feedback on my talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your nice, clear exposition. Are there questions?
You have a formula, some formula saying that U belongs to BV if and only if some limit do something. My question is, do you have some result concerning U belongs to W11 if and only if some limit?
Yes. And we have, to my surprise, a negative. This was a negative result. I was very surprised. This was the first result which completely, I was very upset by this example. It's in Augusto Ponce, who, and it's, he never published it, but it appears in the paper of Nguyen. This was this example that I mentioned. This was the first thing which was discovered, a negative result. And because of this negative result, I almost abandoned the subject. I said, this subject is that's what I call pathology one, you see? It's, there is a function U, W11, okay, better than BV, W11, such that this limit is infinity.
Some characterization.
What do you mean different limit? The limit is infinity.
No, with the L. Some different kind of functionals saying, giving some positive information. Not this one, of course.
Not this one, yeah. For example, the first type of functional that I presented, the one that we used with Bourguin and Mironescu, that was, in this case, used in BV if and only if the limit is finite. So this is a type. So this is a type of functional where you do have that property. But in the other functional, to my big surprise, and I was surprised because point-wise, for U fixed, it converges to the BV norm. So I thought that this would characterize BV functions. It's not. So counterexample. And by the way, now we have. And this is any function phi. So forget about the jump, the Heaviside function, any function phi, you can construct a U such that lambda delta U goes to infinity. And the construction that we have now in our long paper, the new construction, is a fairly simple example of a function U in W11 where lambda delta goes to infinity. And as I said, if you go from W11 to W1p, then it is true. You do have convergence to the W11 norm. And you use this p bigger than 1 via the theory of maximal functions. I don't know if there is another direct, maybe there is another direct proof of this fact without using the maximal functions. I don't know.
Okay, thank you. Other questions?
So you're using no local functionals models on fractional spaces in the limiting case, right? N minus one, n plus one, x minus y to the n plus one to get a kernel, right? And to measure the singularity in the limit.
Sorry, say it again.
So you're using these kinds of no local functionals you're using are modeled on the limiting case of fractional Sobolev norms, right? You use 1 over x minus y to the n plus 1 at the denominator.
N plus 1, yeah. So it's,
okay.
But this is not a fractional norm. This is just
N plus 1. This is essentially.
It's not like in the other where you have plus 1 minus epsilon, which is a fractional
minus epsilon. And this is, in a certain sense, the limiting case.
Yeah.
But then there are variants, anisotropic variants of fractional spaces. In the sense that instead of taking x minus y to the denominator, you take something, some other function that blows up, differently in different directions. Now, can you imagine to do the same and getting in the limit some anisotropic version of the BV norm? There are also anisotropic fractional Sobolev spaces, and then you could consider the limiting case in a sense that every direction is weighted in a different way.
Yes.
And can you imagine to do the same and getting in the limit some anisotropic version of the BV norm?
It's a very good question. I like your question. We have not invested.
So it's essentially a potential other results that you can have in like some Wolf shape of the BV norm or something like that. Getting the anisotropicity in the limit, starting from anisotropic.
I understand very well. I like your question. I think it's a very good question. It has not been investigated. And what has not been investigated is even what happens if you, and this is probably not too complicated, you might want to give it to a student perhaps, you don't take the function which is exactly 1 over x minus y to the n plus 1. You take a function which blows up. Yes, but at first, you want to take a function which blows up like 1 over x minus y to the n plus 1. Can you have a similar result? I suspect yes, but so far there is no, I don't have a complete proof. How fast does it have to be and so forth? And even that, I'm not completely 100% sure. This would be the first step towards the question that you want to solve. And I think you have to start with the first step. Take something which looks like which blows up like that. This needs to be done. Indeed.
Some other question, comment?
I just a question, curiosity.
Yeah.
This approximation of the total variation by the lambda delta functionals can be used, of course, to compute the total variation.
Yes.
Can give some new light about bounded variation functions. It's a little intricate. The approximating functionals are non-local. But anyway, to compute the total variation is not so easy.
Yes.
So I ask if you have, using this your theorem, you have find some application
To prove new results.
Yes.
I wish you were. I hope the answer to your question is yes. But I don't have, I don't have an example. And I would suggest to start not with this lambda delta because that's a complicated approximation of the total variation. It's non-convex, so you lose all the properties, you know, when you make a convolution. Convolution is like taking a convex combination. You don't have you don't have Jensen's inequality or so. So it's those lambda delta turned out to be nasty, and it would be nice if you can prove results in the limit. Those they are nasty, but in the limit, they give new results. I would first start with the first approximation, which was kind of discretization. This approximation perhaps can give. In fact, it's quite useful. I've used it in some other context to prove, for example, that some functions are BV, for example. Here you see immediately that if you have a BV function and you compose it to the left by, say, some Lipschitz function, the resulting thing is a BV function, which is not completely trivial fact.
Yeah.
And here you see it in one line.
Oh,
So in some sense, I agree with you, and also the fact that it maybe give some information about the perimeter, like in the work which I quoted, the non-local perimeter and so forth, can give some insight about the properties of the perimeter. But I would start with I would be hopeful with this kind of approximation, and at this moment not too hopeful about the lambda delta.
Okay, thank you. So, thank you very much again.